you awake or are you asleep?
Both. I don't know.
Pretty asleep.
They're forcing our
I just can't
eyes
look into the light.
No, they're forcing the eyes to close. You know?
Don't look into the light.
Yeah.
Whatever you do. Sorry. Okay. So the basic idea, as I said, is to chat. Feel free to wander. If you're going to curse, we're going to uncut. The idea is to have a conversation. Feel free to crosstalk. Interrupt as much as you like. The less of me, the better for everybody, usually.
Okay.
Because I'm just so terribly uninteresting. That's my speciality, is not being interesting.
All right, well,
so nobody minds that I'm not on camera.
Talk over you, you talk over me. All right.
So yeah, do you guys like each other?
We spend a lot of time together.
Yeah.
We've been spending a lot of time together.
I mean, otherwise we would, you know, if we don't like each other, you would kill each other, I think.
How did you guys end up spending a lot of time together? How did this marriage start?
Well, you know, we met each other already approximately 10 years ago. Dustin was coming to a concert of mine in Italy.
I was living in Italy at the time.
And I played in a place called Ferrara, which is a small town in the north of Italy. And he came there with our manager, Tim. He wanted to look at me preparing the piano with all sorts of objects because he was at that time working on Marie Antoinette, was it right?
Yeah.
And there we spoke the first time, and I had the feeling that, you know, he was a very open, like, friendly person, and I had the feeling that we will maybe become friends. And it continued that we met each other, like, regularly on, you know, maybe at a concert or...
And then we ended up recording for the same label, Fat Cat.
Yeah, in England.
British. Label.
So what were you looking for when you went to the concert? Were you...
Well, I had actually started to explore prepared piano on my own, and then my Italian friend, my engineer, told me about his show, so I went to check it out. I was just starting to explore when I saw his show. He was so deep in it, and then I just realized, like, oh, I can't to it. I can't even touch it because he was already on another so deep. But then we became good friends. And
yeah, and that was very also very nice because of course in those periods where you work on indie labels and you start your records, you are in a way free in developing your own music out of your own impulse. You know, there's no other impulse that is given from the outside, but you have to think about it in a way, what I'm doing next. And I think this is for me, even now working on a movie with Dustin together, I think you can feel actually that we both have as well this kind of own impulse of doing things by ourselves, and I think that is very helpful because that evens out a lot of things. When you're just focusing on one thing, you can every now and then you just do your own stuff, and then you are in a way in a balance, which I really like.
So did it just work out naturally working together? I mean, is it
well, Garth had us in mind. But he didn't know that we knew each other.
Yeah.
He didn't know that we were friends. So it was very serendipitous that he asked us to do it. So.
But how did you figure out what the working relationship would be? What was the?
Well, I think we both because we've toured and we knew each other for so long. I don't think we never really had to discuss how it would work. We just knew that we just had to just jump in and just figure it out.
No, and when you tour together, I mean, you make a lot of experiences about the other's character. I mean, you know, if there's a big ego, if somebody's only like focusing on him, and I would say in a work like that where a lot of responsibility is involved and a lot of parties are having opinions, maybe at that time we thought at least. I think it was wonderful that Garth was asking if I want to work with Dustin, because I felt in a way, we both got along on tour very well, you know, and I always had the feeling that if there's a problem, there was never something where I felt like this is not solvable, or right. you know, you don't get in a situation where you're just like, you know, what are you talking about, you know, something like that. We were, I think, in that relationship during the composition now, we had the same. I think we had a very, we worked separately. We found a good concept how we could start, so we started separately. And then, you know, after, and exchanging ideas and stuff like that. And because in the beginning, I think you need your own surroundings.
Yeah, I mean, you need, like, yeah. We both work out of our own studio so much that we knew that we needed to start it in our own studios and just get the get a feel for the film and just feel how we could fit into it. So that first month we worked on our own, but it was good for them because they were in Australia, I was in LA, he was in Germany, so there was basically a round the clock composer working on their film, so they were getting tons of music every day.
That's always a good impression in the beginning.
Yeah,
when there's something coming, you know, towards you.
So I am trying to figure out how it actually worked. Did you do it and then send it to the other one, and the other one had an opinion, or did you?
Yeah, we always
run everything by Garth. Or
no, I think in the you never send something straight away to the director. I mean, the first thing is you have to find a kind of clear idea and maybe something where you actually say, yeah, that's actually so good that I can send it over, and that at least is a statement. That doesn't mean that this is your only statement, but
right.
At least it's the first draft in a way. And we were sending pieces back and forth, and then Dustin was like writing me, oh, I think there's one thing that I really liked, I will take that, or could you do a sound like this again, or something like that, you know.
Huh. And the ego of it, does that have to be just eliminated?
No, I mean, that was the one thing that was great with working, is that we both realized that the film, when we got the film, it was already so strong and it was so good that we just wanted to arrive at a level that matched what we already were seeing.
Uh-huh.
And so I think both of us were in a place where we just wanted what was best for the film, what was going to work best for the film.
Yeah, and I think, you know, it's of course, it's always a learning process. You can always get in a situation where you feel like, you know, wait, I have to step back a little bit. But we had the feeling, and as well with Garth, who was always, you know, in a way, giving us a lot of motivation, and not like sending whatever notes where we just felt like, you know, like this. He was always like pushing us in a very positive way. Like, you know, it's already great how you do things, but could you do maybe a slight different change here or something like that? You know, and I think that's always it's just slightly different comments that make already a big difference. You know.
So, what was the most challenging part about this particular score?
I think that it was basically just getting the material, pulling it back. It's a very, there's a lot of restraint in the score, and a lot of the performances are single takes, and capturing those. It was, you know, it was just getting the right touch and the right recordings and the right performance of those, which was the hardest part, because everything is just so sensitive. And some of these takes are really long single takes that had to be played just sort of perfectly in the, you know, in the right place.
Huh.
So when you have less, because there isn't that many instruments in the film, and so when you don't have a lot of instruments, you also have to, every note really counts and every part becomes more important, which I like, and I really love that, and I think it works well, but it just makes it, the performance becomes really important. So that was, at least for me, that was...
No, totally. I think it was actually the... Yeah, I think it's a very fine line between, you know, emotional and kitsch. You know, there's a... You know, you just... like one chord too much, one maybe too, you know, opulent kind of gesture, and suddenly you're in a genre where you don't want to be, especially with a movie like that where everything is already said by the acting,
right,
in a way. You don't want to like force it again into that. And I think that was, therefore it was good that we were two, because we could really discuss, and you know, we had two opinions, and I think that made it much easier. And I would wish to have a lot of, about a lot of work, even my records, I'm always looking for the opinion of a friend, because I'm sometimes not, you know, I'm not always sure if what I'm thinking is the only level of, you know, that that matters, you know, so yeah. I need other opinions as well.
You have feedback, and you can, I think it helps everything get better too, because and if it's somebody that you really trust, and we both trust each other and we have a lot of respect, so it's nice when somebody's like, can point out maybe something that you thought like, oh, maybe this could be better, but when somebody pushes you, then it helps you just.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what I think, that's the best way of growing, you know, when you can allow others to help you, you know.
Are there still issues in this film that you disagree on?
No, I'm actually really happy.
Do you just find a place? Do you find that?
No, I feel like, I mean, we worked hard to get it to the place where everything is there. You know, there's some music that didn't end up in the film that I really love. That we, you know, there's other pieces that we wrote, but that didn't work out.
But that's better that way than you're missing scenes where no music is in. You know, where you just think like, oh, there should be some music in there. And I while we were watching it, I had not the feeling that there was, I would do something differently in terms of the place, the place where the music is, you know, placed, and so I'm pretty happy with it.
The composer once said, you know, the more music cues in a movie, the worse the movie.
too much music can kill a film, and you know, things need to breathe. And it's interesting because this film has quite a bit of music, but I think that we also created music that there's a lot of space too. It's sometimes blending into the soundscapes of the sound design and things like that. That just give it. It's not so heavy-handed, and that helps it breathe, even if there's an hour of music.
And I'm not sure if also a good movie has always a little bit less dialogue. You know. I'm not sure, but maybe that's also with this film. There's not so much said, but the stuff or the sentences that are said, you know, they mean something. And I think that gives of course space for the music as well. I think there's hardly no scene where they are talking and music is underneath.
Yeah, there's.
You know.
Yeah, there's almost no underscore.
Yeah, the freedom not to talk is. It's great. As a daring thing, but people who do it often get rewarded for.
Yeah, well, I think creating the film has a lot of story to tell, but it never feels rushed to me. And I think that is that's something that Garth handled very well, and we try to represent that in the music as well. You got to feel like you're going at a relaxed pace, and that you. The audience can settle into the story, and they're not being pushed to, like, you know, cut after cut. I mean, there's a lot of long shots. There's a lot of, you know, it's, the sequences are flow.
So, is it fun to go back to being a solo artist after collaborating?
I don't think. Well, fun. It's always fun to work.
It's a pleasure to it, I guess.
It's always a pleasure to go back to your own work. But that is. I mean, I feel this is also my own work. But it's of course a collaborative work, and it's a different challenge. But it's also something that I really love, and I think it's in a way it makes me as a musician complete in a way that I feel like. I can sit down at home and I have no purpose of doing something, but I'm doing something. And I'm writing music for who knows. knows if it will be a record or if I'm leaving it on my computer for years and that it will grow there, you know. I think that has a kind of same value as when I'm creating music with for a specific purpose with other people together. And so I think that the change is always nice.
Is there more of a sense of complete? I mean, is there a sense that there is a completion point that, that you don't have a choice about? That's different than doing it yourself when you're working on your own stuff.
Well, I think you know. Obviously, this was like a big collaboration with Garth as well, and so I think when he felt it was finished, it was sort of that moment that we knew it was done. You know, when he felt it, because I think that you know he really was bringing all of these elements together, and for the most part, we really felt the film in the same ways. There was just moments where we just had to finesse it, and finessing it took time, and we were trying to understand. It took sometimes just a while to understand. Everybody hears music differently, and everybody perceives music differently. So it was when you finally figure out, oh, okay, this is what you know what you're looking for, and how you're seeing it. And Garth has great ears. He really listens to music, but he doesn't try to get inside your work. But he listens to music in the right way as a director, which is great. He never micromanaged the parts inside. He just was looking at the bigger picture. And I think that was nice. So we always felt like there was always that moment where we knew it was closed.
But I mean, is that nice? As individuals working on your own stuff, you have the freedom to just kind of continue to churn.
Oh, no. Yeah, when you're working on your own stuff, it's never finished.
No, and it's
you just abandon it.
And it's not easier. I mean, you think that it is easier, but it isn't. And what I think is that the collaboration with Garth and Dustin is something that, in a way, sharpens your senses. And also, it takes away your attachment to your own, you know, to yourself in a way. You actually have to understand that if somebody says, I want to have a kind of very sensitive, fragile piece, I mean, I can play Fragile on the piano and they think I'm rocking, you know? So in a way, we have to suddenly understand, we have to talk to each other and we have to say, what do you mean by fragile? Is that like, is that the feeling of the scene? Is that the boy? Is that the nature? What do you mean by that? And I think that's mainly already the main difficulty in a collaboration, that everyone thinks about terms differently, and you know, when you want to reach a kind of similar understanding. And I think that this process is for me extremely interesting and fulfilling.
Are you guys fans of musical scores of films and things? Or is that something that has been in your...
Yeah. I mean, probably older scores, but there's a lot of great stuff going on now as well. That's always been in the... Even when I had a band, and I was always listening to a lot of, like, film scores.
Yeah, same here. I think, but there's also very, like, a lot of bad scores and good scores, and, you know, which is with records as well. So... and there are periods. I have periods where I'm listening to a lot of film scores, and then I'm, you know, I have to do something else, and I'm listening more to whatever, vinyl or older records. So.
Yeah.
When you see a movie, do you hear the music first? Is that the thing that pops for you more than other things, or is it?
No,
not it's really?
No. I think actually, yesterday or the day before, I was actually thinking exactly that about that question, and I actually said to myself, no. You always get excited when a score is good, for my taste, because I'm like getting excited because I hear something where I'm like, who is that? Sometimes I just hear like a composer that I think it is this composer, and then looking at the credits and I'm like, oh no, I was wrong.
I go in and out if I'm really. In the film, sometimes I forget about the music, but it's all inevitably, you know, it's hard not to hear.
Are we in a good era of film composition?
I think, yeah. I mean, I was, this year, there's a lot of really interesting scores. I share a studio in Berlin with Johan Johansson, and the score that he did for Arrival is amazing. I really love it. And
Do you feel competitive with Johan? I mean, sort of
no, I mean, I think that, you know, we're really good friends, and I think it's nice, you know, it's just sort of like Hauschka, we have a really open friendship, and I think that you just inspire each other.
And Johan was touring with us as well. I mean, we were doing one tour with the string quartet, the three of us together, you know, I mean,
we all work very differently, but I think we all have our own voices, and we all are kind of evolving, experimenting musicians and artists. So I think it's nice when you're around that energy, and you feel, you know, you learn a lot, and you inspire to, you know, it's always pushing everybody to explore. And I think ultimately that's what keeps it interesting.
I'm also a big fan of Mika Levy, for example.
I was just going to say, she's doing some really interesting stuff.
Yeah, and yeah. I mean, listening to her scores as well, you would maybe in like 10 years ago, you would never think that this music would make it in a movie, you know?
Yeah.
And it's so like you know, detailed and beautiful. That makes me hopeful.
Because filmmakers are getting more daring about their choices.
I think also filmmakers maybe are in the time where they they collect maybe a certain type of records, and maybe they were surrounded by a certain type of music, and you know, maybe in other periods people were thinking maybe the same thing that we are thinking right now, you know.
Would you like the old stuff? I mean, the stuff that's like the kind of the James Horner of it all, or the John Williams and all that kind of stuff that's more traditional. Totally. Also interesting and exciting and compelling?
I mean, you know, John Williams is, you have to have respect for what he does because he's such a master at what he does. And I think there's very few people who can actually do what he does. There's very few people who will take the time to learn to do it, because we're in a different age as well. And so it's such a detailed craft to orchestrate, and to be able to orchestrate a full orchestra, rubato. You know, you listen to one of my favorite scores is Close Encounters. I mean, just the push and the pull of the music, you don't hear that much anymore in scores. You don't hear that sort of rushing and then the strain and pull. Everything is so metered now. And that's something that I think the last 10 years, I think people are starting to finally get off of that, because they realize everything got kind of metronomic.
Yeah.
And it kind of kills music. Music shouldn't be on a grid. And I think people got really used to that because of the operating systems. But it's starting to, you know, I think that's where people are working also outside of just the classic orchestra sounds, and using treated sounds and creating their own sounds so that it gives a unique identity to a film.
So is that a dying art form? I mean, is it really like something where you have to learn the craft of how to do what John Williams does?
Well, I think that's just one way to do it.
It's one way to do it, and I think it's also not a lot of times. I think that is a big mistake to actually compare these like styles with each other. I think a lot of styles have, great. There are great composers of a certain style that do wonderful work, and I think it's great to incorporate all sorts of styles and look at them and listen to them. It's the same with classical music and maybe contemporary classical music or pop music. There's a certain competition between those, and when somebody wants to be modern, then maybe he thinks that he doesn't have to be classical in a way, you know, but this is totally wrong. I think, for example, John Williams has maybe learned in a different way than we've learned, because we learned a lot of things by doing. Yeah. And I was actually, when I was a young man, I was always told that this is nothing worth, you know, but the academic education was the value, and my experimentation and my fun on, you know, on free fall in a way, yeah, was not valued in the right way. And I think over the years I found out that actually the education has as well like a flip side of things, and which doesn't mean I can learn from academic people and they can learn from me of being free in a certain way, you know. And I think if you can combine that, that's wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, that's sort of, maybe the modern approach is, you know, we've grown up making our own music and learning how to record ourselves. And so actually, I'm really involved in how things are recorded and the microphones and how it's placed and the chain and of the signal chain is really important to me and the sound. Mm-hmm. And that's a big part of creating a unique recording, and that's something that I always approach with every instrument is how to record it, what it's sounding like, how we're capturing it. And then treat, and then also not being too precious with it either. Maybe taking it and slowing it down, you know, pitching it down, and or you know, doing manipulating the sound as well. And that's an influence of electronic music and experimental music.
So in the past, that would have been a guy in the booth with a half-smoked cigarette making choices for you, or not?
Morricone really paved the way for a lot of that experimenting. Yeah. You know, he did a lot. I mean, the 60s and the 70s in Italy, there was all kinds of crazy experiments that they were just doing.
For Shutter Island actually reminds me a little bit of Michael Levy at times. There's some like the there he actually scores the boat at one point, like for the POV of the boat. Mm-hmm. And you get that big sound.
Yeah.
It's like, wow, okay. It's just fun to hear it. You know, yeah. People pushing at that envelope where you don't expect it is kind of exciting.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's what It's. I mean, Bernard Herrmann did a lot of that. I mean, there's so many great like experimentations that happened, and I think film music when it got into this sort of orchestral, and that's how film music should be, just like this classic pristine. Orchestra is just that's just that it works and it's right for some films, but it's not. It's just it's one way to do it.
So the past does not have to die for the future too.
No, absolutely.
I mean, I think we're able to like grab bits from everything, and that's, I think that's the beauty of, I think maybe where we're at now is, it's a hybrid of a lot of stuff.
And also maybe we're able to actually accept that there's, we don't have to be against something just because it's actually. When you are against something strictly, I think a lot of times that is that also could be an excuse for your own insecurity in a way. You know, not for everything, but I mean, especially in terms of music in categories, I think. But I think when I'm looking back and I'm listening to music from older times, there's so much music that is so touching that I was not aware of. For example. I mean, the whole Italian music from 1400, 1300, that's so complex and, it's so wild and where people in our days think they are wild, you know? But then you look at that time and you're like, what? You know, they were writing this music or they were playing this out of their head. And, you know, I think the only thing that bothers me a little bit is maybe that the computer, in a way, I have the feeling sometimes takes away the capacity of the brain. And I think it would be great if they can coexist next to each other, that, you know, that in a way that you get, or my kids actually start like putting the computer away and they, whatever, get the ability to get complexity in their own, you know, like remembering, writing things down. Writing a score with your hand and remembering everything and figuring it out and then writing a piece of an hour, you know, that takes years, you know. And I think that's, they did a great job at that time, you know.
Well, it seems like every time technology comes into whatever field it is, that it's like there's that period where you actually lower the level of quality because the technology is more important than the work in some ways, and then you figure out it's a tool and not everything. You know, instead of being a false god, it's just another thing you have on your list of tools.
I mean, it's definitely enabled. I didn't go to school, so everything I learn is through doing, and it's enabled me to have a tool to communicate with orchestrators and then learn how to orchestrate myself, because now I have something that I can communicate an idea to, and through that I've learned how to do a lot of orchestration on my own, and that's been something that's great with the technology now.
So when's the first time you guys saw this movie with an audience?
It was a TIFF.
No, the last time or the first? The first time was at a TIFF. It was in Toronto. Yeah.
So for you guys, is it nerve-wracking to...
Well, that first time is always nerve-wracking because you don't know. You know, you sit with the movie for so long.
Yeah.
And then you're in a room full of people who haven't seen it, so it's that, you know, you can feel that, you know, you hope that that it projects in the right way.
But at the same time, it was great. I think we were talking about that when we were at TIFF. We were saying it's so nice actually to sit with all the guys that were working on the film together in an audience. You know, which a lot of times when we perform, we sit on stage and we have the audience right there, and we play a piece and we get straight away either an applause or people leave, you know. And that's like there's a pure reaction directly to what you're doing. And I think with film, it takes so long. I mean, you work and work and work, and until it's actually finally there.
Yeah.
And you can feel actually this tension, like you know that they were waiting for this 2 years or three years, you know.
And do you get the satisfaction when the audience, you know, reacts well to the movie as they did to this movie?
Yeah. I mean, we had a really, it was really nice at TIFF. I mean, they gave the film a standing ovation, and it was really like, but it seemed everyone seemed really touched by it.
Yeah, and they were also laughing at some places where we were. I mean, I was very surprised, which is also fantastic that you saw a scene over weeks and weeks and, you know, and you felt like, okay, I'm curious what people think about that, you know? And then you get reactions that are totally, totally unexpected, you know? And
well, it must be satisfying at some level that as composers, you didn't tell the audience what to think and you let them had their space.
Yes.
Got surprised that way.
Yeah. You got to give them space. I think audiences need more credit. I think that's with a lot of films. I always feel that, you know, it always makes me sad when I think, you know, the film's been around for 100 years. So give the audience a little bit of space and credit that they can follow something and they don't need to be, it doesn't need to be hammered in or it doesn't need to be so directed. And then people actually have a chance to come to it. And I think I think Garth had a really nice sensibility with that, to let people kind of fall into it.
Hmm.
More and more, I think that's just what everybody wants.
I think so as well, because I mean, I was recently, you know, I think the last time we were here in LA in a cinema, we were watching, I'm not sure which movie it was, but the music was so loud that I was actually like, you know, I was sitting like this in the chair, and where you just think, no, I'm not in a club, you know.
Yeah. Well, it's funny because sometimes those movies like scores get this, you know, great acclaim, and sometimes I'll like watch one of those movies and I go, that's the worst score ever. It's like it's painful because it was too much. It was just like, let the movie breathe, and then people somehow are drawn to that sometimes. They almost want to give up the responsibility, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And just be told, you know, But you know, the more I do this, the more movies I watch, the more I, you know, like analyze how people think about movies, I just think if they have a chance to feel something, you know, whatever it is, the thrill of an action movie or an emotional movie like this, that's why we go to the movies. That's why we interact.
Yeah.
You know, that's why we prepare our pianos.
Absolutely.
Which you're still doing.
Yeah.
So digital has not replaced your prepared piano?
No, but I mean, I have a, which we also used on line. I have an effect board next to me where I have some delays and reverbs, and I have a loop station, and I'm looping myself. But no, digital, on my new record, I'm using the first time like a synth that I'm, you know, I mean, I have many synths and I love them. But I had the feeling at the time, you know, when I was already playing in bands in the 80s, and we were playing so much synths that there was a period where I couldn't hear like a Oberheim or, you know, I heard all these sounds already, and I was spending as a kid like years in synthesizer places with headphones, like, you know, figuring out what the best sound, and when the new model was coming in, I just went there and I was trying this out. And then there was a period where I felt like...
See, we were in America, like, playing guitar.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Well, there's actually a documentary about the first drum machine, I guess. There's like a whole talk about how influential the drum machine, I forget what it's called.
Lindrum. Is it the Lindrum?
I think it may have been the Lindrum. It was whatever that one thing was ended up being like the voice of early rap and the voice of like every disco song, every whatever.
Yeah.
And you didn't realize it, but it was in like every single song for five years, 10 years, and then finally went away.
Yeah, also the whole, I mean, you can actually see periods of the material that you had as a, whatever, when you were 17, and then you look at the charts. And I mean, all the bands were using these certain sounds from Yamaha or for the DX7, or, you know, there are periods of technology that you can actually see in the songs. Yeah.
Well, we won't look that closely at Lion. We'll enjoy the bringing together of many different voices.
Yeah.
Or at least two of them.
In Lion, you can sense a little bit of history of piano.
Yeah.
You know? Slightly.
Slightly. Thank you guys for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Appreciate it.
All right.